And I'm also a mommy of two children with special needs. And I'm the founder of Mary's Grace. It's a small version of what the CLC network does, that we can build services for children who are differently able and help churches and congregations work with in North Carolina to be more inclusive.
And I'm Barbara Newman, and I'm a special education teacher whose students kept getting kicked out of their congregations. And that piqued my interest. So now I am also, in addition to being a special education teacher, I am our church services director for CLC Network. We're about to change our name. We did a rebranding thing, and you're going to love it. Our new name is called All Belong, Center for Inclusive Education. What do you think of that name?
Good.
Yeah, exactly. Nobody does. So we changed our name. All Belong makes sense. So, but basically, isn't this a beautiful picture? And I think we are helping the congregation say, how do we get to that place where we can worship together as one? People of varied abilities, lots of variations in many forms, but our organizations really focus on persons with varied abilities. And today we want to talk about children and youth, because I've been a special ed teacher for a very, very long time. And I have heard from congregations, wow, we have all these kids that come in and they just sit there with their hands over their ears. Oh my goodness, what are we going to do? We have all these kids. We've got at least 62 with ADHD. I'm like, you know, yeah, probably we do. So, but that's really true. You know, a family comes to your church and this is one of their family members. What do you do? What do you do when all the kids are in the handbell choir? And what are we going to do? Because this is all of the kids. So what do we do, you know, when you've got a second grader in children's worship? And second grade is what you have staffed with two people all the way through, because one was never going to cover it. So, you know, maybe you don't even know what's going on with some of the kids, but you know they need some extra pairs of hands. You know, you've got a three-year-old. You have no clue what's going on with a three-year-old. But there is this individual, and it's like, oh my goodness, this person's just fit everybody in the preschool choir. You know, what are we going to do with that? And I think, too, you know, we're in a time where it might be that we know what's going on, but we may not. We may have no clue. We just have kids come to Vacation Bible School, and here they are, and you're supposed to pull it up. And I think sometimes we just want to hand you a bucket load of tools. Not that you have to do every one, but they're in your pocket now. Some things to think about and try as you're thinking specifically about children in youth settings. You may need to interpret a little bit, because it's been a while, although I was a choir director of children a while back, it's been a little while since I've been in those shoes. So hang with me, interpret, you know, turn it into something that might be usable in your setting. But really want to give you some ideas. My favorite, and it's not up here, but I always think, you know, it's those kids moving into the middle school, and you say, oh my goodness, what's going on? And I say, it's probably just a combination of Red Bull and hormones. So, you know, it's this age where what's going on with you? But I think we have some ideas for you to get prepared. And LaTonya's going to talk a little bit about what that might look like.
So we always use a three-part plan. This time we're using the three P's. So when you're, I think on your handout, it will say perspective, participation, as well as personalization. So we'll go walk through that a little bit and see how we can help you all. Again, we're not music people. You don't even want me to sing. My people turn my sound, my mic off at service. They know when it's time to sing to turn my mic off. So perspective, and I meant to grab a pinky ring puzzle piece.
Wonderful.
So perspective, when you think about this pinky ring puzzle piece, it may not make any sense why she's holding a pink and a green puzzle piece. But we talked about it a little bit in our first session. Green is about those things that come easy for you, that naturally you kind of can do. For me, that's talking in public, whether it's scripted or not. I can usually stand up and shoot it off the top of my head, usually on a great day. But pink are those like hot spots, things you don't do that well. And for me, that would be, ironically, driving around foreign cities. But we've done well in the last couple of days.
Yes, we have.
We are close enough from the hotel to here.
And
now it's going back to my green. I made it without GPS from the hotel here, so I'm very proud of myself today. It's all the three turns, but usually I can't do that, right? So we think of that people, you see people as just a disability, or you possibly see people as just whatever their condition may be. For my daughter, she has cerebral palsy or cerebral palsy. And for some people, all they would see her is cerebral palsy Taylor, right? But she's more than that. She's got some things she's really great at. She has CP, but she plays basketball and wins awards every single year. It blows my mind how this child can do this. But learning is very difficult for her. So we all have those pink and green identities or things that are within ourselves that are characteristics. One of the things that we will talk about is participation. So I met Barb a few years ago watching her at a conference, and she talked about this thing called universal design. And I was blown away, and I've never looked at an elevator the same since. That and a garage door opener. Never thought of it the same way. Universal design is us teaching ways of giving you ideas of how you can prepare for anyone who may universally show up. Like, who will show up at your service? And being prepared for whoever that is. Like the elevator. It was designed for someone who could not climb stairs, but guess what? I saw a lot of people use the elevator with us earlier today, and they were all able-bodied. None of us were had a wheelchair, but it's there. They build a building with the elevator as they're building the building. My brother's a general contractor. He does not build a building and then throw the elevator in afterwards. No, it's a part of what that building is. It's built with that building. So that's what we're talking about. What is it that you can do in your service that's built into your service, built into your church identity to prepare for whoever may show up at your door? And then personalization is kind of the same where I think both of us have done a lot of work. But for my church in particular, I have an education, a master's in education, and was a school teacher. I was not a special ed teacher, but I worked with children who were in inclusion models in the classroom. So I worked with kids who had IEPs or individualized education plans, kids who had 504 plans, and tried to figure out how do we include children but cater things to their needs. So responsive design is a model where you're looking at how you can work with that particular child, that particular person, or that particular adult. We've done some responsive design lately at my church for some of our older population or my seasoned saints who can't move as well as they used to move, but they still want to participate. They still want to do some of those things that they've always done. And how do we make those accommodations for that particular person? So universal design, what can you do for whoever will show up? Responsive design is, now that Susie is here, what can we do for Susie and her family?
So we are always talking about, you know, that always be prepared. And this is why I'm excited for children. This, to me, is the best bang for your buck. If you are going to focus, I just do a bunch of stuff. Have it available. You're going to have VBS. You're going to get kids with sensory differences. You might as well have a quiet break area built into your vacation Bible school. You're going to have situations where you're going to need those tools for kids. We're going to go through a bunch of tools that is consistent with that, always be prepared, that elevator. How can we put some things in place, as LaTonya said, expecting children with varying abilities to show up? Because guess what? Anybody here think that you have children with a whole wide variety of abilities within your congregation already? Do you agree with me? So these are ideas. You don't have to wait until you meet Mary. A couple of them, although I'll preface that, might fit more into a personalized plan, but I wanted to show them to you because I won't have that chance later on. We're going to talk again about worship tomorrow. We're going to talk about those personalized plans. How do you put that together for an individual? So that's on tomorrow's docket. But I want to just think about the prep work, some things that you can do as you're thinking about children and youth. And one of the most important things, I think, is to create an expectation within your congregation that this is indeed a topic you should be thinking about. One of the ways that I often do that is with true-false quizzes. I did a quick one earlier the last time, and I said, thumbs up is true, thumbs down is false, what do you think? So we'll see how well people who came to the first session retain. If they were to give a statistic for how many people in the U.S. have some sort of a disability, that number is, do you remember 20, what it is?
25%.
Yes, between 20 and 25%. 25 for adults, 20 for the general population. So we're talking about a large chunk. And I think even beyond that, if you think about children, their varied interests, their unique personalities, you may have some who have been adopted into a family, you may have some children with a trauma-based background, you may have some children who are just varied because of their sensory system. I don't know what that may be, but children come with a variety of packages. And so we just want to put that in place. But so often, if you get leaders, part of the being a leader means that you're also expecting, being your children's choir, that there will be children of varied abilities in there. So I think creating awareness within the congregation is important. So let me try this one, true or false. For a woman who finds out she's going to give birth to a baby with Down syndrome, 70% of those mothers terminate that pregnancy. True or false? Do you hope it's false? It is false, but do you know what the number is? It's 90%. I think that's a call to our churches to act, to give that puzzle piece perspective to our congregation to say, not in this place. We see that valuable, incredible image bearer. We want to embrace every child within our family, within the heart of this congregation. Can we use some of those questions, some statistics, in a powerful way? Let's try this. I wrote a book called Autism in Your Church, and I found out never put numbers in your book, because that's the truth. The first edition said numbers in autism, one in 166, something like that. Next year, out of date. Out of date immediately. One in 150 it was, and then it kept going. Do you know what it is, numbers in autism today? So do you have more than 59 kids in your church, statistically, right? Or your congregation as a whole, divided by 59? Do we need to know something about autism spectrum disorder?
Yes. Do you think that's because it's diagnosed more quickly, or that more people have it?
A lot of factors go into that. I do think people are getting much better at being observant of what that means. But there are a whole lot of factors. They don't even know yet what causes autism. They can describe it, and they have a lot of strategies for it, but they still don't know the cause. So, yeah, those numbers have dramatically increased. When I graduated from school in 1984, so don't do the math, I'm 56. In 1984, numbers in autism were 1 in 10,000. Yeah, I've got to be speaking. Anyway, sometimes I do that with the congregation because it's a quick way to get out some information. What does that look like? Check with your school district. How many kids, especially, or you, have some sort of a diagnosed situation going on? Well, if it's 20%, guess what? You can expect, volunteer, that 20% of the individuals in front of you will have some kind of diagnosis that doesn't count for the fact that they all do, because they all have unique puzzle pieces. So, again, we really rely on scripture, have different tools that might be helpful. I've written a few books along the way that might help encourage congregations to pass out that attitude to people. But I think that's a big part of getting prepared, is just making people aware that that's true.
Can you go back with one real quick?
Oh, yes, certainly.
The books.
And as any good author does, I have samples people can look at, but all of the materials are available online if anybody's interested in, you know, some stuff.
So when you think about working within your congregation, I'm a pastor of a predominantly African-American church. So on Sunday morning, out of about 150 people, I may have two white people in my congregation. And that's the only other race that you may see. But if you're dealing with a multicultural congregation, you kind of have to really think beyond your own comfort zone and beyond your own cultural history. And think about how you were treating people, how you're approaching people, because cultural perspectives can change the way you do this kind of work. So like I said, when I met Barb, I was sitting in the room and I was amazed by the work that she was doing. And I remember looking at my husband, who had just gotten married a month before that, and I looked at him and said, I'm supposed to be doing that, but I can't say what she's saying in my black church, because it's a different cultural component to that. So you have to be aware of that. So we worked with a young lady by the name of Maria, and I always say her last name wrong, Cornu. And she talks about, from the Hispanic population or Latino, Latinx population, that saying to a mom, you know, let us take your baby and take care of your baby during the service is highly offensive, because her identity is rooted in taking care of her child. And for a black community and African American community, it's the same concept. We want to know that our child is protected and taken care of. We're very hesitant to give our children over to people. Can we figure out why? Right? So So we have to begin to think about that. Now, doctoral work deals with the fact that in my own cultural background is dealing with the historical elements of slavery and how we have dealt with the fact that we were told very early on in life that if a child is born with a disability, we have to hide that child, protect that child, because the master would kill that child, right? Or the master would take that child. So what does that translate into now? That means we don't talk about mental health in the Black community. We don't talk about disease. We don't talk about disability. We hide it and don't tell anyone. My cousin is one of those people who has a child who's born with Down syndrome, and I've shared with Barb, I've never once heard her say out of her mouth that my child has Down syndrome. Her child is 22 years old. She hid the fact like we couldn't look at her and tell. She hid the fact, and none of us, all educators, could help her because she wouldn't let us help her. So we have to deal with that when you're dealing with making these programs and coming up with these great ideas for them, that you need to know them first. And know the culture. Understand who you're dealing with. Understand ways that you could possibly be offensive. And how do you understand that? It's not always reading a book. It's talking to the people that don't look like you, that may not sound like you, may not come from your own cultural identity. But learning those things so that you're preparing your church and congregation and your community. Because I'll tell you, when you begin to build these programs, your context may change. The people in your congregation may change because they'll learn about your program. They'll begin to come to your service. So when I said we only had two white people on average service, now we have a group home that attends our church because they know that they're welcome. And I have one, and he just has to wave. And the first few times he would stand up in the back corner of the church and wave, everybody wanted to sit down, like, let him sit. Right? You're not supposed to do that in church. What I learned was all I had to do is wave. In the middle of my sermon, he would sit right back there. Mm-hmm. Right? Learning how to connect with people begins to expand what kind of people the congregation you'll have. So taking the time to learn some of the history and the cultural perspective is really important. And one of the other things that I love to do is work with churches and doing audits. This is a list of different resources that you can use to do like accessibility audits. I love this because my brother's a general contractor. So I grew up, and my father's a contractor, I grew up around construction all my life. And so I can usually look at a building. If I know what year it was built, I can tell you whether it's in compliance or not. I'm just that geeky kind of girl who knows odd construction facts. But walking with congregations to think through accessibility from a different lens. We're good at walking into a building and we're looking at a building and thinking, do they have a ramp? Do they have cutouts in the curb? What are the little things that we all think about, right? I do this for people at other churches, but you can't even get into my church because we have no push buttons. And so I'm finally fighting my deacons after 3 years. You all, those doors are heavy as heck. We've got to put in push buttons. So their answer for 3 years was to have three hostesses stand outside and open the doors for people. But it worked while we could. But now we're trying to make sure we're taking the time to be accessible. Thinking about, do you have a zone where there are no fragrances? Thinking about accessibility building as well as accessibility once they get into your building. It's really important.
So I'll see how good you guys would be at this. I had a phone call not too long ago. They said, you know what, we've done really well. We have a child in a wheelchair. Through third grade, this has worked. But our fourth and fifth and sixth grades always meet on the second floor. And so we've had to talk to the parents and tell them that she really isn't going to be able to attend the children's programming next year.
Hmm.
Got any ideas for this congregation?
Switch the classroom.
That's what I was thinking, but I had to say that in a kind way. But so sometimes it's just a matter of we always do it this way, or this is our facility. And some congregations do have unique church structures.
And I have another quick example. I had a congregation call me 2 weeks ago, all in a panic. We have a person in a wheelchair who's never been baptized. What are we going to do? And I said, baptize the person. Yeah. And they were like, but how do we baptize someone who can't physically get out? I said, have you ever thought of a pool lift? You can rent those, right? Because mm-hmm. their baptism pool isn't in their church. It's really not that safe anyway. It's outside of the baptism facility. They're able to rent a pool lift to baptize the person, take them right back out. Mm-hmm. And so what they're doing is they reached out to all the the communities in the neighborhood and asked if there's anyone who has not been able to be baptized, who's professed their faith and want to be. We're going to have a baptism for people who are wheelchair bound in the community. Isn't that powerful? Mm-hmm. All because they picked up the phone and said, what can I do? And I said, we're at a toilet.
Yeah. Talk about a great announcement in the newspaper to feature what a
church's heart is. Hey, we just want to let you know this, right?
Cool.
Very cool. Again, back to being prepared. So, attitudes. People have to be with you. They have to be expecting that there are people of varied abilities, children of varied abilities who are going to be there. Sometimes accessibility pieces are important. But I want to introduce you to an idea that I'm really excited about. This is one where we put this tool together, but here goes. So now I think you guys can really come along with me. This is not an actual book. It's a book that's an instruction guide. Your book is actually what you enter on the website where it sends you, okay? My name is Donovan, and I want to tell you about my church. Now, you're not New Life SDA in Huntsville, so you're going to put your own picture of your church and put your congregation in there. Here's a picture of my church. It's called New Life SDA. I stay with my family for a little while. Then I usually go to a room for children's worship. Here's a picture of where I can be with my friends. Now, I got to tell you, these kinds of stories where you just describe what's going to happen are really powerful. But I started to think, while this tool is great, I do this all the time. What about kids who are going to join a newly formed youth choir? What is it going to be like? Would it be good to have a little story on your website or pictures? Or you are inviting them into from second grade, now they can join this choir. So could you do a little thing, a video, some pictures, describe what it is. This is what we do, and we sing for 30 minutes, and then we have a snack, and you show a snack table, and whatever that is. But how exciting. And let me tell you, all of us like this. Who here looks up a hotel before you stay there? What are you looking for? About many of our programs, whether they're for worship as a whole or worship for a children's setting. What a beautiful thing for a parent to sit beside a child and go through the story of what's going to happen in whatever choir that would be. So if you have a website, if you don't, you can have books that can do the same thing. But that kind of preview of information can be really, really powerful. So think about different ways that you might be able to do that.
When you're preparing for the people who may show up, make sure you're taking the time to get some quality training for your staff, your choir directors, whoever's going to be in contact with this family. CLC Network has a great and vast plethora of training materials that I have personally used. I highly recommend them. I tell the choir I need their staff because I think I sell their stuff when I sell my own. But why reinvent the wheel? They have great materials and videos that you can actually purchase to prepare your congregation and to prepare the leadership. Not only just the leadership, but even the peers. If you're going to do one-on-one support, they have plenty of materials to get the right training in front of your people to prepare them to work with all populations. So taking that time to learn and to keep growing and developing your leadership is very important.
So, yeah, you know, again, I was children's ministry director of my own church for about 14 years, and that's where I learned to make videos 1 hour and you serve food, because everybody stays for 1 hour and you serve food. So those are all exactly 1 hour in length, and many of them are very appropriate for children in youth set. So, yeah, and I think the other thing that we've really recommended to congregations as a way to get prepared is, how many of you have a registration process? Parents have to fill something out before they send the kids. So here's the best suggestion, and it relates to this puzzle piece. Plant a question on there, and it should not be this one. Does your child have a diagnosis of some kind? Many parents are not going to fill that out. And so what we usually recommend, and there's a sample of this on our website, is to plant a green question about the gifts. Everybody fills it out, so name, address, whatever. Tell me about your child's strengths and gifts. And in parentheses, you're going to list things like getting along with others, athletics, computer skills, musical skills, whatever you want to know about that kiddo, dot, dot, dot. But then you ask the next question, tell me about some of your child's struggles and challenges. Same set of things, social skills, you know, whatever that list is, computer skills, musical skills. Because now, number one, universal design, we're asking every parent to fill this out about their child, and it's sort of helpful information. But the other thing is, it is way easier for parents to write down a set of qualities as opposed to my child has been diagnosed with. So
So again, it's a way to get some information, and we have found that to be hugely helpful. If you want the exact wording on our website, Resources for Churches, we have that form for you to follow if you would like. And then, it's helpful, I think, too, within a congregation to have somebody sort of in charge of this initiative, whatever you want to call this person or this committee, but to have somebody whose eyes are sort of focused on this so that they can come alongside the choir director, they can come alongside the Sunday school leader, the youth group leader, to give resources and ideas. The other thing that I just wanted to mention, and I don't know where you guys are at with that, but we do offer a membership for churches, for congregations, so that if you say, hey, we really would like some expertise, we as an organization can partner with you, and we'll send you monthly trainings and give you access to trainings, but you also get 10 SOS calls during the year. So when that family shows up at VBS, you can say, excuse me, we don't know what to do. And then we will help coach you through that situation. And that has been helpful for many congregations. The other thing that I would recommend is that part of, oh, LaTonya, no, that's all right, this is online. Part of the thing that you need to do is to have that process that leads into that personalized plan. So you have a process in place when it's time to happen. So when you meet 80, what are you going to do? We have a manual, we call it glue, but that is a way to write up a personalized plan. We're going to give more information tomorrow. But planning that into your universal design that says, look, if we see a child and we know they're going to need more than what we can provide, this is the person we contact, or this is the route we take. Does that make sense? So you're not flustered. You know the answer. And I think that that can be helpful. And of course, always begins by getting to know that child. All right. I want to stop just a minute because one more thing. I also get a lot of questions, too, with people who work with children and youth. How do you bring up this conversation with a parent? Like, if you have to talk to a parent, what does that look like? So back to this puzzle piece. One of the conversations that I often recommend is this. And it goes something like that. So if greens were gifts and the pinks were challenges, hang the green in it. Hey, how are you? Oh, I loved having Jonah with me these few weeks. He comes into our children's choir and he has the energy of 10 people. His smile, his radiance, he is just an incredible guy. What a singer. He's got volume, pipes. Oh my goodness, I don't know where he got that from, but he just sings from his toes and happy. I can tell he loves to worship. I noticed when I asked him to sit down and do that, that can be sort of challenging for him. Have you noticed that?
Yeah.
So what did I do?
Share the green.
Lots of them, right? Lots of green. How many pinks did I share? And did you notice I did not say, by the way, I think your child has. Okay? I described it. You know, this is what I've noticed. I've noticed, you know, whatever that might be. And then there we go. Now, I handed it off to you. Have you noticed that? Now, mom has two choices. She can either say, like you just did.
Yes, I've noticed it.
Yes, I've noticed that. Now we can have a conversation about, wow, okay, I wonder if we can brainstorm about some strategies, something to try, because we really want this to go well for him. And but you can also say, right, I never noticed that. It never occurred to me that there's right. No, but then I'd say, always as a coach, claim the blame and say, you know what, I wonder if it's the setting or something that's going on. Could we have a conversation and just talk about what you do at home? So either way, I'm going to get my conversation. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And I think that that is a beautiful thing. The other thing that I often recommend, just for children's settings in general, children and youth, is to have a list of some trusted individuals that a parent might be okay going to if they do need to get an evaluation or some extra help. Because then you have that ready list and say, you know what, I don't know if this is helpful, but if you want to get some more information, these are three numbers of people that other parents in this congregation have trusted. Does that make sense? Okay. I have talked a lot in LaTonya, is about to talk a lot, but I think one of the things we'd like you to do is to say this. What's the best idea you've heard so far? What is something that you're pretty excited about doing? Would you find somebody close to you or two or three people close to you? And just talk about that a minute. Do you like that idea of having a hotel website for your children's ministry? Is there a
Is there a training that you want to make sure you have as a staff? Where are you at? So talk to someone close to you about what should that study be doing so far. Mark spoke about this data collection earlier in the intake process. We do this as well at my church, not that particular form,
but one very similar. But once you have that form, is it just something that you're chucking into a drawer, into a file cabinet? No, you actually need to take the time to read it. And that's where I think a lot of churches miss out on opportunities to make that connection with parents and when they're coming to your church. Reaching back out to those families. Do you know how shocked they're going to be to hear from somebody from your church by Wednesday after they've been to church on a Sunday? Just to say, we want to say we thank you for bringing little Johnny in, and we were excited to meet Johnny. We look forward to working with your family in the near future and hope to see you back. Do you know what you're going to do to that family? They're going to go, oh my gosh, they remembered us. Even if you don't remember what Johnny looks like, his name's on the card, right? You've got to figure that out, to reach back out and make those connections. And then begin to think about how you can support that family. Instant buddies, my church is, we're a small church, so I get to brag off them. We have seen maybe 150 people on a Sunday, but again, I'm in Roxboro, North Carolina. You've never heard of Roxboro, North Carolina. There's no way you have, I promise, right? But we have instant buddies. We don't call them instant buddies. They kind of just, my youth ministry just kind of sees children, and they just rally around them. And then the kids never want to leave. And then their families end up joining our church. So we have the opposite problem of most churches. We have more children, I think, some Sundays than we have adults. Because they have been trained a lot. I've been working with them a lot since my children came to the church. Because they realize that we've got to make some accommodations for Hunter and Taylor. I talk about Taylor, my daughter, a lot because she has cerebral palsy. But my son is on the autism spectrum. He's very high functioning. We didn't get his diagnosis till last year. And I do this for a living. I kept saying, there's something not quite that I can put my finger on, but his social skills, if Hunter met you, what's your name? Jahida. Jahida, he would be like this, hi, it's so nice to meet you, you're so pretty, I like your shoes, and he would be on you like that, right? And so I kept saying, socially, he's not getting those cues. What can we do to help him out? So we didn't get that diagnosis for a while, but our young adults and our teenagers realize Hunter likes to be close, so there are people who don't like to be close to people who are on the autism spectrum, who distance is a big issue. They begin to rally around, and those buddies create systems of who was going to work with who without the adults getting involved. And then we begin to train them and educate them even more on what's appropriate and what's not appropriate. For that tough customer, it's okay to ask parents to wait until you get something together. So we have a young fella, I keep referring to poor Jason, with his mother's permission I get to do this. Jason lost his father a year and a half ago. Mm-hmm. Jason, we felt like was on the spectrum. Mom was still wrapping her mind around what would happen if he had his diagnosis, and would she even get it tested? She came to me and says, I think my child's autism, what do I do? And I said, we have a team of people who will walk with you through this process. Once Jason was tested, and it's a process, it's not a one-day test, and you come out and say, yep, he's got autism. No, that's not how this works, it's a procedure. Well, once we figured out what Jason needed, it took us a while to put everything in place. It is okay to say to a family, we really want to work with Jason. Can you give us a couple of weeks? Can you come back with us and you sit with us until we're making sure he's comfortable or she's comfortable? Can you help us until we're able to help him on our own? I think they will be okay with you saying, give us a little time. Now, not asking them to join every youth group for the next 6 years, no. Just a couple of weeks until you figure out what's best until he's comfortable, and asking for time for those accommodations that you may need to make for that child.
I think, too, speaking of Insta-buddies, one congregation, they had a few people that were very comfortable. They were assistants in a special education setting. They didn't want to volunteer for any other job, but they were willing to serve as what they call Insta-buddies. And so if they had a child and they're like, whoa, we need some pairs of hands, it's then that person would step in beside that individual. So, you know, lots of different ways to do that, natural, but also an appointed position so that you have that coverage. Huge suggestion for BBS, have four. People who are not assigned but are willing to just step in when that kiddo shows up and are very comfortable helping that child navigate through the BBS activities. So just an idea. Same with youth group, although that's a little different. You can often find somebody who's willing to serve as that alongside, and they just slip in when they notice that something's going on. So to have that person available within a choral setting, I think it'd be really, really helpful, a coach for an individual.
Here's some ideas. Again, these are going to come very rapid fire. I absolutely love this set of stuff.
Turn half of your mom.
Oh, you could too. This is totally falling apart. Here, I'll give you this one. One of the things that we have found is that some people really need schedules. And whether that is an order of worship, which is going out of style in so many places, please don't do that. But we'll talk about that pretty soon too. For kids, maybe that has to look like a picture schedule. So what's nice is that if you have this available, either for everybody or for individuals, you say, oh, you're at church now. Oh, yeah, that's right. Now we're done playing. What's next? And so it's a way to move through a series of activities. And people know what's next, and many like to just take it off when they're done so that they have that. Another thing that we have is this lovely piece of material. Once you are excited about pictures, there are so many things you can do with them. So this is actually the material that's on the underside of your vehicle on the roof, and Velcro sticks to it very well. So if you're working with children and they're in a setting where they're going to make some choices, you literally can go to a child and say, what would you like to play with? Okay, now you're going to edge toward that place of maybe a personalized plan. But I think the other thing is maybe you are in a place where you're leading a prayer of thanksgiving for kids, right? What are you thankful for? And you know that child's not going to be willing to share that in words, or you may want to get a second option. So you're simply wearing the options. What's really neat is you do have a child who has significant inability to move hands or feet or whatever that may be. If I'm standing this close, I don't want you to say a point to it. I just want you to look at what you're thankful for. You are thankful for food. Anybody else who's thankful for food? Right? Now we can put that into a prayer of Thanksgiving. But these are some of those ideas that really help back up what you're going to do. So you can make song selections. You literally can put whatever you wanted to on this apron. So you have different cues for kids. You can wear them and you're going to take them away. Maybe you've got three cues and you've got two. But again, it's a way to bring visuals into something that is often a words-only kind of presentation. The other thing, so let's imagine that you really weren't very much into wearing aprons. You totally can put this, you know, use it to cover a stick or whatever else you wanted to do. But those kinds of things are cool. The other thing, and again, I don't think I'd stop this every day, but this would be more of a responsive design plan. I just wanted to show this to you. These are wonderful tools. They're speech buttons. And so let's imagine that you're going to have the kids as part of their Christmas program, that they're going to all say a piece of a verse. So, you know, Mary gave birth to her firstborn child, right? So if the child can push the button, alright, then the rest of the readers can go ahead. So again, what happens is, the question is, what can this child or what can this youth member do? And could we incorporate that somehow? Mm-hmm. So if you have multiples of these, they can be choices. What do you want to sing? What do you want to do? But a simple thing like this can open up doors for participation. And I think that can be pretty cool. I've seen some churches do amazing things with handbell choirs, actually, with individuals with areas of disability. And because of some color coding that I don't have much information about, they were able to bring the handbell system that worked very well for some kids. And so that has been a delight. I think the other thing too, and again, pictures are great. So if you use a certain story or you want to introduce something to the kids in that setting, buy a second copy and cut things up. Because if you can take the pictures and turn them into the cues that kids can choose from or pick from, they've actually seen those pictures in the display that you were using. So those are just, that's a little more advanced than I really wanted to go into universal design, but I wanted to show you that as soon as you have pictures and some very basic tools, I think you've got a lot of options. The other thing that I will guarantee you is that you have kids who have varied sensory systems. So let me just describe this for a quick moment because we have a few minutes. A keyboard, middle C, are you with me? A very comfortable place for a sensory system to be. If you are wired at middle C, you block out a whole bunch of stuff. There might be noises in this room. LaTonya's sitting down right now, but again, we don't pay attention to a bunch of stuff because it's simply not important to our sensory system. But you can have some people who are wired either way above middle C or way below middle C in any sensory system. So let's just take hearing, for example. Do you have any people that they're so hypersensitive to noise. And so they cover your ears, and you think this is going to be delightful because you've got kids like that loud, or you have a certain worship leader who's always starting, come on, let's sing! Or they don't come that Sunday. Again, a little bit of noise in that person's brain registers as the very loud noise. Let me just get a drink from it. On the other hand, you can have some individuals who are way below this. These individuals talk in voice well like this most of the time because, you know what? They're not monitoring their own voice volume very well because it takes a ton of noise to even register. Okay? Now, this can be true in any of the sensory systems. It could be touch. Do you know anybody who pulls all of the tags out of their clothes? Or they're not putting their shoes on until their sock toe line is exactly right in their shoes because they will feel it all the time, okay? They're very sensitive to that. I have a son like that. He ripped out every tag, holes in his shoe. On the other hand, there are some individuals who are touch hungry. They love, they give you a hug, they squeeze you so hard you think your liver's gonna pop out of your body, you know? And you say, come on over and sit down, and they're sitting right there in between you two because they can touch you all the time. Okay? So I guess what I'm trying to say is that in a congregational setting with children, this variation is a guarantee. Am I reminding you of any of the kids you know at this point? So how on earth, and this is true for adults too, how on earth do you figure out what to do with this particular situation? I had a couple of unique ideas. There's one church that just systematically stops noise-blocking headphones. They have a bin. They even have universal design in their bulletin. If any family member would appreciate noise-blocking headphones, they are available for checkout at the visitor desk. So anybody can go and check out a pair of these that just muffles the sound in a worship service. I think the American Hearing Association has an agreed-upon decibel level. I would guarantee you that this morning's worship service was above that level, where I was sitting. You may have some dead zones in your congregation where the sound is naturally going to be lower for people to sit and listen. Mm-hmm. How great for families to know that if they have somebody. Have some churches, very hot, popular right now, a second setting in which people can worship. So you have some individuals and families who you offer, like movies do, a sensory-friendly worship experience in this particular. The sound is able to be turned down, lights up, and movement is now free. Amazing, the church I was just at, how many persons who were over the age of 75 who chose to worship in that space. But again, you know, there are so many different creative solutions that can work within that setting. So these are some different things. One of the other things is just stocking some different stuff for children's settings. They use these in schools all the time. Does this look familiar to you? Office staff use these sometimes to develop core strength. But these are things that kids can sit on. Kids that use this might say, wow, it moves for me, so I don't have to. And so we just say, stock some equipment, put some of these things in your setting. Besides, if there's a child or a mom or dad walks into your children or youth area and sees some of this stuff and they know their kid needs it, what if you just communicate it to that family?
You're welcome. You're welcome.
You are welcome here. We were thinking about you. We got you covered. So I'll show you a few more things. I think these are two great things to stock, just have around. But again, there are so many different things. They actually make these fidget pencils, which I think are great. It just is an end stick, and we forgot to do that this time around, but that's okay. We often make these just available. One church was all excited about this, and what they did was they put, they called them pew pouches, and on the end of each pew, they put a little fidget bag. Feel free to use a fidget item if it makes it easier to listen. Please return items to baggie after use. Do not get items that make noise. But to make those available during choir, to make those available during a children's setting, just stock the stuff. Put those things in place. On CLC's website, we have a suggested list of items you might want to throw in that bag. But also, LaTonya, where did that basket go? I don't know. Yeah, you can look through that basket after our time together. Maybe send them around that. So the other thing that I guess I was thinking again of those children's settings, if you have children's programs, children's things, these are my faves. They're called parking spots. Did you notice what's a little bit different about this one from a typical carpet square? Pardon?
It's round.
It's round. Yeah. What else? Yeah, it's that was just in a hot. Many times we give people carpet squares, and as soon as a child sits on that carpet square, what happens to it? It disappears because they have covered it up. This, they can still see the boundaries. So you have to be able to imagine the boundaries of what's beneath you. If you get something larger, you can still see them. The other thing, big room. Hey, now we're going to organize this space. We're all going to go and we're going to sing this room. Please stand on one of the parking spots. Now I have just said, okay, this is where I'm supposed to be. Again, finding it. Going to work on a Christmas program? Oh my goodness, train the person to a spot if you know that they are going to have difficulty. It is way more comforting for a kid to walk into a situation and know where they're supposed to be. Put a reserve sign on something. Have that be an identified thing. But these are great. A company called reallygoodstuff.com makes these, or I think you could just, you know, have somebody who's handy in your congregation pull that up. The other thing is if you're thinking about, you know, having scissors and pencils and things, there's a variety of things that you can have in place. I'm not going to talk about this much at all because I don't know that that's necessarily where you all are at, but one size does not fit all. And so to just stock some variety of things and let kids choose. One piece of advice, if you do begin to introduce some equipment, you can blame me. Hey, I heard this lady from Michigan come in and say, this might help our children's choir. So I wanted to get some things for you all to try. And I always say, make sure you tell them, you know, if I give you one of these things or you choose something to try and it helps you participate more and it's working well for you, great, you can keep using it. If not, then we'll give it to a friend. Because this has clearly turned into a frisbee a time or two, and at that point, you need the right to take it away from somebody. So again, that's just a word to the wise. On our website, I think you can have access to it. If you can't find it, you can email me. We actually have a little story, like one of those information stories, to introduce other items to a group about how to use them. Again, it's all about teaching kids how to use those things. And then finally, I just wanted to talk quickly about multi-sensory options for kids and some invaluable items. I think one of the things that is important is that we all need those pictures. We all need those choices. And I think choices give kids power. How many of you run evening opportunities for kids or youth? There are so many children these days who take medication that lasts about 12 hours, and you can feel it run out at about 7 p.m. And there is this energy that happens in the room. The truth is, that's when a kid is most vulnerable and least attentive, when that medication is going out of their system. So to really have some choices and to have some options and to have some ways that people can move is really important. Also, have some food backup, because that person probably hasn't eaten all day. That's one of the side effects of that medication. So I know many of you run evening classes, and that can be a really important thing to have some options for people. Choices empower people, and they are one of those things that says, okay, I can do this. So I might often say to somebody, you know, would you like to stay sitting there, or would you rather enjoy the rest of the time standing in the back of the room? Which one do you want to do? Again, I'm good with either choice, but that kiddo is available to move if they need to. So, and then I just wanted to introduce you to a couple of items that I think are invaluable. I absolutely love these timers. Some kids don't do well with time, and this is called a time timer. How many of you are familiar with this? Wow. Okay, you're going to love this. So you set it, and it comes down red. And when the red is gone, time is up. So kids can watch your practice time, your singing time, your play time, before you pull them over to the rug, disappear. And then you're not the bad guy. You're not the one stopping them from doing what they wanted to do. Say, oh, you know what? That red is almost gone. So get ready, because I think it's about to disappear. That clock is there, which enables you to stand alongside the kids and move into the next activity. TimeTimer.com also makes this one, which is actually a whiteboard. You can write down, hey, we're going to do these things in 30 minutes. So these are the four songs we're going to practice, and then it is snack time. And so you literally know that this is the four things you're going to do while this timer goes away. Does that make sense? I love this timer. That and schedules. Again, you're not the bad guy. It's the schedule that says this is what we're going to do. So I could see if I were leading a choir, I would totally look at the picture icon for the songs we were going to work on and let the kids see exactly what that's going to be. The other, I think I'll skip that because I don't want to. Let me just make it have those options, you know, to give kids break tickets, an opportunity to hand them a ticket and they know that they can go out and get a drink or do what they need to do, especially if you're running an evening group for kids who you know are on medications during the day. Those are just some ideas. Talk to your person that you were just, what are you going to bring back? Did you get something that you think you might be able to try? And what are your top three? Could you talk to the person next to you just briefly about that? What are your top three? They may not have that. Could they draw some pictures that are part of the scenery that you're going to use? Could this person be able to use one of those push-button things and have access to participate in a different way? Are they able to take a shaky egg and be part of something using alternate methods? And I think it's always about, okay, if this is something where we really want everybody to participate, are there some things we can think of that are in our back pocket that we can pull out to say, no, we'll make this work for so-and-so. If you factor in those sensory differences, provide some things, especially sound sensitivity, that is huge right now. Provide some movement options, some of those fidgets for people to hang on to, that's great. And don't forget that those information stories are your best way to teach kids, I have found. Explain to them, this is what's going to happen, this is what it looks like, this is what we're going to do. So those kids that freak out now that you're going to put together a Christmas program and on December 22, this is what's going to happen, teach them what it's going to be. What's their role? Where do they stand? And for one individual, maybe they participate in practice, but you know it's going to be very difficult for that child to pull off that performance. Could they participate via video? Could their part be taped ahead of time? You know what I mean? So if our true joy is all, how can we create those avenues? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And also, they're going to be helping. And then now you've got leaders
in your choir that will advocate and help them all of your six.
I love that.
Yeah.
I love that. Well, the first book I wrote is called Helping Kids Meeting Kids with Disabilities, because that information piece is critical, isn't it? Very good.
I was just going to say, for those of us who don't need to be in the front of the line, could you share your stories again? Because I think a lot of people were here and they were.
Oh.
Or do you mind?
Would you like that?
I would. And I heard of.
Okay.
If
you can give us 5 minutes, we will do that. If you want to get out and do that, we'll hurt them the first time around. That's fine too. Want to share your story?
Sure. I worship the team decided to do an African American church watch night service. So New Year's Eve, every year we have a watch night service. And so one day we decided we were going to have balloons drop, and we had these sound makers, and we were going to do all these great things in service. As a pastor, I make sure I told the older people what would happen. So before midnight hit, they turned the ones who weren't hearing aids turned them down because they didn't want these loud, you know, the noisemakers that you blow. I told my daughter, balloons are going to fall down. It's going to be great. And she was so excited. And her little friend Jason, that I spoke about earlier, warned them that these balloons are going to drop down from the ceiling. It's going to be great. But I didn't think about the noisemakers. So as I'm standing in the pulpit counting down the new year, right here at 11:59 point whatever. And at midnight, we all went, yay, and blew their horns. My daughter was the first one under the pew screaming and crying. And Jason followed right behind her. I forgot the noisemakers. I forgot what it would do to my own child. And having to get out of the pulpit as the pastor, crawl under the pew to get my daughter out and hold her until she could kind of calm herself down, was more powerful for me. I thought about everyone else in the congregation but my own kid. And that was an eye-opener to always think about who's in the room and what am I doing from the pulpit, from the choir, that could impact them in any kind of way.
And I just shared the story of my father, who passed away in February from end stages of dementia. One of the things that I noted is that the conversations we could still have together were conversations that were based in worship. That is the language we could share up until the day he died. And one of the things that we did at Christmas Eve, we couldn't open gifts on that Christmas Eve, and I think this would be so cool for children's ministries, but to his room where he was the most comfortable, we dressed up the great grandkids and grandkids and did passages from scripture. They acted it out. We did first verses of songs. Dad sang along to everything. And then I turned in at the end, and even though he had very few words to say, I said, Dad, would you close in prayer? 5 amazing sentences fell out of his mouth, just because that's the language he learned when he was young. He learned when he was young, and those were the things that remained true in his heart. And then I shared the story to the end. I had no choices sitting across from his dad. Do you want me to say scripture, or do you want me to sing a song? And he indicated scripture. So I did Romans 15:13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And very uncharacteristic, he indicated I should do it again. So I did. This time when I got to that, so that you may overflow with hope, I go, stop! Like, oh my goodness, first of all, he didn't have much volume. But he said to me, hope for me. And I thought, oh my goodness, he could use scripture. Come up with a question that he wanted to ask me. And I think, how can we dementia-proof our children's ministries? Mm-hmm. How can we feed them those things that will be there to be sung to them and said to them when they are 92? You know? How important that my dad and I shared a language together, and that his grands and great-grands knew those songs well enough that they could be part of that common language. Children's ministry, I think, wow, how can we get people to think, how can we put something lasting, because those were the memories that my dad had, and by the Holy Spirit's breathing on those times together, that's how we communicated, and we could have wonderful conversations through song and scripture and prayer.